The tension in Kano was palpable during the last days of February. While international forces have begun to disarm armed groups, progress is slow and the atrocities persist. Meanwhile, around 1,000 people from the Muslim community fleeing to Cameroon have found themselves trapped in the town. They are now living in the Catholic Church compound under the protection of African Union soldiers. This is an explosive situation that degenerates regularly. After a night of clashes, several casualties with bullet wounds were brought to Kano Hospital, where MSF is working.
He was shot twice in the shoulder and a bullet exited through his armpit. He has lost a lot of blood and he's in shock.
MSF decided to send an emergency surgical team from Bongi to cope with the influx of casualties. They referred the most serious cases to the capital and stayed in Kano to continue to treat others.
So we prepared the operating theater and then we operated on two patients. We were able to do it here because the surgery was minor and only required mild anesthesia and routine post-op care. While we were finishing up, four more casualties were brought in. We'd been told that two had minor injuries, so we weren't expecting the two children. One is a little girl who has a gunshot wound in her neck. She is suffering from shock, but it doesn't look serious. And then there's her little sister. Her condition is deteriorating rapidly.
This influx of casualties reflects the violence that is so prevalent here. But despite the tensions, Médecins Sans Frontières is well regarded by all the various communities. The teams assist the displaced at the church while working in other of the town's districts. They also continue MSF's activities at the hospital, where the organization has been providing support since 2010 to the pediatric, TB and HIV units, irrespective of whether their patients are civilians or fighters and the side they are on. This truck from the Central African Republic has just entered Garobalai, a small town in Cameroon that has transformed into a refugee camp. On board the truck are dozens of people, most of whom are Muslims. They have endured a dangerous and harrowing journey that took several days to escape from the atrocities committed by anti-Balaka militias.
They killed my father and my mother, my sister and the rest of the family. It was the neighbor who killed my mother and father, and that's what really hurts.
In both Chad and Cameroon, the MSF team see refugees who are deprived of everything, but above all, food and shelter. In Gohe, one of the main crossing points to Chad for Central African refugees, 6,000 people live crammed together around an old hospital. Women hang their veils on branches to provide a little shelter. They will be hopelessly inadequate when the rainy season starts in a few weeks' time.
Plastic sheeting for shelters is going to have to be distributed in a few weeks at the end of March. It might be a problem.
Il va falloir également qu'on soulève la question de
utensils like hygiene and cooking kits are also going to be an issue. Some of the people here were lucky enough to be able to bring some things with them, but the majority fled with nothing.
Ils ont juste fui sans rien.
Those arriving in Chad face yet another problem as they are not recognized as refugees. Although some may have Chadian nationality, for the most part they are Central Africans. Living temporarily in transit centres with very little access to aid, thousands of people await while governments and the United Nations decide what to do with them. With an estimated 500,000 new cases annually, drug-resistant tuberculosis continues to spread. Worryingly, direct transmission is now responsible for a third of new cases in some East European countries.
A patient with tuberculosis can transmit the disease to around 10 people in a year. And if it's multi-drug resistant, these resistances will also be passed on. So you can see why it's a problem and why we have to find a fast and adapted response.
This patient is suffering from a particularly acute form of the disease, extensively drug-resistant tuberculosis. He was treated, but there were multiple side effects, and the disease showed no signs of regressing.
I can't hear anymore. I can't hear at all in this ear, and only vaguely in this one. But I'm taking the new treatment and I feel better. I'm less worried. If I continue this treatment, I'll be fine.
This new treatment is a combination of drugs that includes bedaquiline. Clinical trials on this new anti-TB drug have not yet been completed, but initial results are promising and have made way for compassionate use of the drug. Only 250 patients in the world are receiving it, patients who have failed treatment and for whom there is no other option available. 26 people in Armenia are already on this treatment. While it is too early to judge how effective it is, some are already showing signs of significant improvement. But using this new drug solely as a last resort is not the answer. MSF considers it essential that research efforts be stepped up to develop as quickly as possible more effective and less toxic drug combinations. Every day sees families torn apart and people fleeing from conflict and persecution. Women are forced to take to the road alone, often with just the clothes on their backs. Life for displaced women is particularly challenging. They are vulnerable to rape, they frequently have no means of contraception, and some are pregnant, with no access to healthcare.
Every woman in the world is exposed to have a life-threatening complication during delivery. That means that 15% of the normal deliveries will face a life-threatening complication. If you don't have access to healthcare, but it's usual in an emergency setting because they are in a refugee camp, but probably the healthcare didn't arrive, they will probably die.
In the capital of the Central African Republic, Rabiatou explains how she was pregnant when she was forced to leave her home with no warning. She is living in a hangar near Bangui Airport, where she waits to leave for Chad or Cameroon.
I started bleeding on the way, and the only clothes I had got bloodstained. I thought I would die before I got here. I had the baby, and they were worried because he didn't cry. The doctor took us to the hospital, and they resuscitated him.
Women from South Sudan and Somalia know Rabiatou's story only too well. Many have their own similar stories to tell. Countless women have had to flee to neighboring countries. They need protection, obstetric care, and access to family planning. MSF works in four facilities in Afghanistan, two hospitals in Kabul and Lashkargah, a trauma center in Kunduz, and a maternity unit in Khost. The teams also run mobile clinics to the east of Kabul, delivering healthcare to remote communities. But still too many Afghans are deprived of medical care.
But we see and we hear from a lot of people, from elders outside, that there's still a lot of women dying within the village. They live far away and it's for them very difficult because there's no transport, because the road is bad, or because they just don't know how to get here or due to security. The idea is to support certain health centers, and then we would make sure that even if the woman is poor, they get to us in time.
In Afghanistan, health is often held up as an example of the reconstruction effort. But a recent MSF report revealed the gap between the rhetoric and the reality, because access to healthcare is all too often synonymous with danger and sometimes even death. And as international interest in Afghanistan wanes, MSF is witness not only to a war that continues to rage in many of the country's regions, but also to the failure to deliver an adequate response to the increasing medical and humanitarian needs. Thank you.